Okay, so I'm going to hand back to Prasanth.
Thanks a lot, John. So that was an interesting panel discussion on the digitization and the upcoming changes in the financial services sector of India. Moving on, we'll have the next session on the role of data in credit decisioning, and especially for the small and medium enterprises. We'll be joined by Abhishek Kothari, who is the co-founder at Flexi Loans.
Hi, Prasanth.
Hey, Abhishek. Welcome to.
Thank you.
You have a presentation, right?
Yes, I do. So what I'll do is quickly just introduce myself and then go forward to the presentation.
Sure. Okay. Over to you.
Thank you. Hi, everyone, for spending this afternoon with on the API Days conference. It's a lovely set of sessions, and I've been hooked on to most of the conversations that's been happening during the day. A lot has been spoken about financial services and the role of APIs and technology in democratizing the data. And one of the important elements, and if you, I just want to, while we will introduce Flexi Loans and myself later, there is, if you look at how the top 10 companies by market cap has changed over time. Go back to 2008 and look at 2018. And I've kind of excluded 2020 and onwards because of some irrational market behavior. But if you look at the top 10 companies, it's a complete shift from an industrial revolution to a digital revolution. Apple, Google, Microsoft, Amazon, Tencent, Alibaba, Facebook. What you see and hear on a day-to-day basis are the tech giants who are disrupting everything that was conventional about the world. And look at any metric, you will realize that about 40 to 50% of the businesses that you see as leaders today will not exist as leaders or even exist in the next 10 to 15 years if they don't transform to accommodate new technologies. Because if they don't, then somebody else will and come back and disrupt them. So where does the digital revolution and all come from? And of course, there's a lot of things that speakers have spoken about. I'm going to focus on a specific sector of Indian MSMEs. Because of what has happened in the last 5-10 years, there are three things that have happened significantly in the Indian MSME space. And let me first tell you what an Indian MSME means. An Indian MSME is effectively the shop owner that you buy your groceries from, that you buy your mobile phones from, that you buy your pharmacy medicines, and so on. So typically the pharmacy owners, the kirana shops, the apparel shops, the stationery shops, that's the MSME segment. There are about 6 crore such MSMEs in India. There are 60 million of these MSMEs. And I'm going to give you some startling facts about these MSMEs. They generate about 50 to 60% of Indian employment, but they only get about 10 to 15% of bank funding. So 94% of them have never borrowed from a financial institution before. 50% of them do not even have access to formal credit. And by formal credit, I mean the typical banking infrastructure that most of us would go to for a loan. Tier one, there would be still some penetration of banking and financial services. But as soon as you go to tier two and three, tier 3 and 4, it becomes thinner and thinner. And what does this mean? Why has this happened over time? Historically, lending is one of the oldest trades in the world. I mean, civilization, go back to civilization at its start. The two oldest trades were sex trade and lending. People used to borrow, and sometimes they used to borrow in the form of a barter. Sometimes they used to borrow in the form of currency. Today, what we call as loans. And typically about 50 years ago, when somebody in India had to take a loan, the typical model was a Jaan Pehchaan based model, which is I know the bank manager, or the bank manager knows my family. They know I have assets. They know I have land. They know I have a shop. And so I will get a loan from them. And as we started developing and digital revolution started to come in, the three key factors started getting disrupted, which was the branch model is becoming more and more cost ineffective. And so the three key problems to convert lending to a digital landscape is, how do you access these SMEs across 30 plus states, different languages, different expectations, different business behaviors, and so on? How do you access them in a cost-effective way now that you have digital rails? How do you assess them? Let's say I was to find that there is somebody in Gorakhpur who needs a loan. How do I find out whether they are credit worthy or not? So assessment is a challenge. Now, for some magical way, I was able to find out that they were a good borrower. How do I service them for the next 12 to 24 months without having a branch or a physical or an agent infrastructure? And that is the problem that Plexi Loans is trying to solve. We are trying to solve the problem of financial access at a click for MSMEs in India through a completely digital layer of access, assess, and service. We are today a company of 250 people, all of them in Bombay, and we service Pan India, 11,000 pin codes, 1,500 cities, with no agent and no physical infrastructure. And a large part of it has been about solving the problem of access, assess, and efficient servicing. Now, how is kind of the technology coming into a play here? If you look at MSMEs, they're all getting aggregated already. The restaurants are getting aggregated on Swiggy and Zomato. The Kirana shops are getting aggregated on various platforms. E-commerce is aggregating a lot of these MSMEs on their platform where you go and buy digitally from. Payment processors QR providers are aggregating these MSMEs on their platforms. So there's a little bit of aggregation that is already happening, and there's a consolidation and some kind of central access to these MSMEs that we can get if we partner with these players. And so today, we are one of the largest players to access these MSMEs through the partner network. And I'll show you how that is being done. So if you look at it, Plexi Loans as a platform has access to all of this demand through deep integrations with the e-commerce providers, with the payments providers, with the food tech providers, with other digital ecosystems. And this was unimaginable if you think about it 50 years ago, because the ability to pull data from a Flipkart server and bring it into a Plexi Loan server through a proper consent layer was seemingly impossible. But with the help of APIs, with the help of deep integrations, with the help of web technologies, mobile technologies, etc., we've been able to develop a pipe between all of these players, which is a single pipe that allows access to all of this data to be brought into the platform. Now, the second part of it, of what we were talking about, was how do you assess them? And this is where a lot of science comes in. In order to, everyone is leaving a digital exhaust where there is some data about you, me, the Kirana store guy on internet, on various databases. And the trick is to be able to find out how you can take all of this data and develop a risk model which takes a variety of different data sources in order to find two key factors. Is this person able to give my loan back? And is this person willing to give my loan back? And the intent and the ability to repay the loans is where the alternative database risk models come in. And I'll tell you some of the very interesting things that we do using APIs. So where is this data sitting? This rich data to identify whether a person has the ability and willingness to pay back the loan is sitting in your bank statement, where we can figure out whether you have enough transactions happening in your banking to prove that you will be able to repay the loan back. And in the previous session, Mahesh was talking about the cash flow based lending. And this is effectively it. If I can intercept and assess your cash flow, I can figure out how much money you're going to make in the next month and the next month and the next month, and I can give you a loan accordingly. This data is sitting in the form of reviews and ratings, which people leave about a business online. So we have technologies which can effectively pull these reviews and ratings from various providers, which could be used in the risk model. All of the partner data that we spoke about, how much is this person selling using Flipkart? How much are they collecting using Paytm? How much are they collecting using Google Pay? All of that transaction data starts to build and tell us whether there's enough cash flow or not. A large part of this data is sitting in bureaus, where every lender has to report the performance of a loan back to the bureau. So we pull data from all the bureaus and we do our custom underwriting on it to see whether they historically this borrower has had the intent to pay back the loan or not. A lot of data is also sitting on your mobile devices. So the device tells us how old the device is. Is the device new, which could indicate some sort of a fraud happening? If the SIM is new, it could indicate that you've just taken the SIM to borrow and then you will not be contactable. And so the whole mobile app data, your behavior of device usage becomes very, very conducive to finding out whether the person can be given a loan or not. Now, in the core infrastructure that FlexiLoan hosts is where we get access to these merchants through partner network and then assess them using these proprietary data pipes and the risk models that we've built, which effectively are used for a variety of things. So while it is important to find out whether the customer is going to pay back the loan or not, it's also important for other use cases. For example, is the customer serious about taking a loan or not? After you have given a loan, it is important to do an early warning system on how the business is going over time, because you've given a 24-month loan and every month the situation of the business owner may change. And so this data is now becoming usable for a lot of other things. Now, we build various custom scores. Each of these scores are available through an API for our partners. So now it's about orchestration of experiences. Now that you have lending in the form of APIs and microservices, where you've broken down lending into onboarding, underwriting, KYC, compliance, servicing, etc., how do you take this experience, take this technological capability, and exercise or orchestrate a new experience? And I'm going to show you a very interesting thing because we've got 5 minutes left. So let me use this time to show you a real application of how we use these to create a very unique experience. I'm just going to show you a quick video. So this is a chatbot which uses all of the capabilities that I spoke about. And it effectively brings the entire lending experience in a chat window. So imagine you see a Facebook ad. You're a business owner, you see a Facebook ad that FlexiLoans is able to give you a loan on the same day. You click on it, you land on this chatbot, you see the various products that you can get. And this is a live chatbot. So let's say you want a line of credit, you click on it, you want to apply for a loan. And you'll see in 3 minutes, this customer will get a loan. In this case, of course, this customer is me. The chatbot will collect some basic information about your phone and your email address. And then it starts getting more personal. Now the chatbot is asking me about my date of birth. If the format was wrong, the chatbot will prompt me to put it in the right format. Now I put my date of birth. The next question is, how much loan do I need? Let's say I need 2 lakh rupees of loan. I mean, may or may not service all the PIN codes in the country. And so they're asking me a PIN code. Now, imagine each of this is an API that is talking to something. So the PIN code, the API has figured out that this is a PIN code of Mumbai. And so they've said, okay, yes, we service Mumbai. You're a proprietorship. You registered your business in December of 2000. So you've got 12 months of vintage. At every stage, an underwriting call is being made to the server to figure out that should we proceed further with this application or should we tell the customer that you're rejected now or we cannot service you. So at every stage, there's an API call that is happening, which is powering this lending experience. This is where it starts getting more fun. The chatbot asked for a PAN number. I took a consent by giving a TNC default acceptance. Now, the moment I've had the PAN number, using the PAN number, the date of birth, and some other fields that I've collected over time, over this journey, now a hard pull is made to the bureau to figure out if this customer has taken past loans. There's typically a 30-second gap in terms of getting that response back. So during this time, the chatbot is asking me about my cash flow. How much of monthly income, how much of margins do I make? Now I've received the response from the bureau. So it says, okay, hey, you've got three loans running as per the bureau record. What's the EMI that you're paying on these loans? I say I'm paying 10,000 rupees of EMI. Now the banking engine kicks in. It calculates the eligibility based on what I've told the bot so far. This is a soft eligibility and you're eligible for a 3 lakh rupee loan. I like the offer. Let's go to the document collection process. So in the document collection process now, and this is where it starts getting deeper into computer vision technologies and machine learning and artificial intelligence. So I clicked the picture and the picture is shaky. Now the API call was made to my computer vision system, which recognized that this is not a readable document. And so it says, hey, shaky hands, you have to upload it again. Let's say I upload the picture again. It's clean. It matches with the data that I've sent earlier in the form. And so all good. Now I need my Aadhaar card. Here I have mischievously added my colleague's Aadhaar card. So the system says, nice try. This Aadhaar doesn't seem to be you unless you're Batman with a dual identity. Now I put my own Aadhaar card in a different format, which is not vertical but horizontal. System understands it, reads it, matches it with the previous PAN and the other form data, and says, all good, your documentation is complete. Connect your bank statement through internet banking and done. It took 3 minutes for us to complete this loan application. And that's what the power of these APIs are. That's what the power of creating an infrastructure on APIs is, which allows you to now convert that borrowing experience into a buying experience. We all love to go to an e-commerce website and buy something with 5 clicks. This is effectively that, but you've got money in your account. Now through NACH, UPI, account aggregators, OKIN frameworks, we are doing better and better in terms of getting access to these experiences. And the next 2 to 3 years are going to be exciting because of all the work that India Stack is doing on the lending experiences side. But I'll take a pause here. I think we're just at on time for some Q&A, if there are any.
Hey, Abhishek. Yes, there are a couple of questions. So what is the delinquency rate on these kind of collateral-free loans? If it is low, why so?
When you go to war, you can't expect how many people will die in the war, especially if you're the first one going into the war. So these are uncharted territories. Where every fintech is experimenting on loans and experimenting on segments. So the trick here is not to track delinquency at a point of time, but to track delinquency as a trend. Because if your system is learning and is able to bake that into the risk model, then you should see a reducing trend in delinquency. On day one, it could be higher, but on day 100, it should be lower. That's principle number one. Principle number two is you should have the ability to price the risk. If your system is telling you that this cohort of 1,000 loans can expect a 10% delinquency and this cohort of loans will expect a 2% delinquency, then you should be able to charge 8% higher on cohort one than the cohort two. So the trick is about pricing the risk and continuously learning to reduce the risk. We typically operate in the range of 3 to 5% of NPAs, which is one of the best in the industry. And that's because of the fact that we learn and we price the risk correctly.
Okay. Yeah. So the next one is, has the economic fallout from COVID-19 resulted in a spike in loan defaults? And how do fintechs or banks prepare for such contingencies?
Yeah. One of my favorite questions these days. Everybody's asking me that. Look, naturally, these kind of macro events, I would compare that with like a 2008 financial crisis, where typically when the market crashes like this, in today's times, it's health crisis, NPA spike. But there are restructuring moratorium benefits that have come in regulatory. There are other things that we can do to protect those NPAs. There is risk covers that CGT MSE kind of schemes would provide. But typically, everyone should expect that the NPAs would roughly double from where they are for any lender. And that's purely because the market is going through a turmoil. How do we protect, how do we kind of manage this proactively? Sometimes these health crisis, COVID kind of impact, you can't predict. What you can do is you, as a lender, you need to have enough liquidity in your system to be able to tide through this wave. Because lending is a full contact sport. Someday you will get hurt. It's a sine curve. When the market is bullish, everybody's business is growing, everybody's taking a loan, and then something happens. It could be a GST impact, it could be a demonetization impact, it could be an ILFS impact, or it could be a COVID impact. Now, these cycles are coming in more and more frequently. And as the new age lenders that we are, the thing that we have learned from this is to be agile about our policies. So the day COVID happened, we stopped taking exposure on categories which are hit significantly. And we can now control this on a week-on-week, month-on-month basis. So we can say that, okay, this month, travel seems to be opening up. So we will do short-term loans of 30 days for travel merchants. But and then we'll observe it after a point of time. So NPAs will rise, have risen. There is no doubt about it. We have enough liquidity to manage it, control it, and live to see another day. And the trick is to never, lending is not a valuation game. It's not a game where I could actually do $1 billion of lending tomorrow. It's only about the fact that the last EMI of the loan is actually where I make the money. The rest everything is my principal coming back. So the profitability of a loan you see after 24 months. So it's not about what you do today. It's about what you see after 24 months, whether all of your money with EMI has come back or not. And hence, it's a game of patience. Financial institutions are not built in a day, but can be destroyed in a day. So patience, ability to tide through this wave, a little bit of agility, and it's a mix of all of these things that that make somebody a good lender.
Great. Wish you all the best in the journey.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot for joining us and sharing insights.
Thank you. And have a good day. You guys are doing an awesome conference today.
Thank you.